Hi, I'm back. I'll be reading some more from this book, Bridge to Terabithia. Okay. We're up to chapter 10. Chapter 10. The Perfect Day. Chapter 10. The Perfect Day. He heard his dad start the pickup. Even though. There was no job to go to. He left every morning early to look. Sometimes he just hung around all day at the unemployment office. On lucky days, he got picked up to unload furniture or do cleaning. Just was awake. He might as well get up. He could milk and feed Miss Betsy. Get that over with. He pulled on a t-shirt and overalls over the underwear he slept in. Where are you going? Go back to sleep, Maid Belly. I can't. The wind makes. Too much noise. Well, get up then. Why are you so mean to me? Will you shut up, Maybelle? You will have everyone in the whole house woke up with that big mouth of yours. Joyce A-N-N would have screamed, but Maybelle made a face. Oh, come on, she said. I'm just gonna milk Miss Betsy. Then maybe we can watch cartoons if we keep the sound real low. Maybelle was as scrawny as Brenda was fat. She stood a moment in the middle of the floor in her underwear. Her skin white and ghostly pimpy. Her eyes were still drooped from sleep, and her pale brown hair stuck up all over her head like a squirrel's nest on a winter branch. That's got to be the world's ugliest kitty, thought, looking her over with genuine affection. She threw her jeans into his face. I'm gonna tell Mama. She threw the jeans back at her. Tell Mama what? How you just stand there staring at me when I ain't got my clothes on. Lord, she thought he was enjoying it. Yeah, well, he said, heading for the door. So she wouldn't throw anything else at him. Pretty girl like you can't hardly help myself. He could hear her giggling as he crossed the kitchen. The shed was filled with Miss Betsy's familiar smell. He clucked her gently over and set his stool at her flank and the pail beneath her speckled udder. The rain pounded the metal roof of the shed so that the plink of a milk in the pail set up a counter with him. If only it would stop raining. He pressed his forehead against Miss Betsy's warm hide. He wondered idly if cows were ever scared, really scared. He had seen Miss Betsy jitter away from PT, but that was different. A yapping puppy at your heels is an immediate threat, but the difference between him and Miss Betsy was that when there was no PT in sight, she was perfectly content, sleepily chewing her cud. She wasn't staring down at the old Perkins place, wondering and worrying. She wasn't standing there on her tippy toes while anxiety ate holes through all her stomachs. He stroked his forehead across her flank and sighed. If there was still water in the creek come summer, he'd ask Lisa to teach him how to swim. How's that, he said to himself. I would just grab that old tail up by the shoulders and shake the daylight out of it. Maybe I will even learn scuba diving, he shuddered. He may not have been born with guts, but he didn't have to die without them. Hey, maybe you could go down to the medical college and get a gut transplant. No, doc, I got me a perfectly good heart. What I need is a gut transplant. How about it? He smiled. He'd have to tell Lisa about wanting a gut transplant. It was the kind of nonsense she appreciated. Of course, he broke the rhythm of the milking long enough to shove his hair out of his face. Of course, what I really need is a brain transplant. I know, Lisa. I know she's not going to bite my head off or make fun of me. If I say I don't want to go across again till the creek's down, all I gotta do is say, Lisa, I don't want to go over there today. Just like that. Easy as pie, Lisa. I don't want to go over there today. How come? Because I called ya 3 times already. Maybelle was imitating Ellie's prissiest manner. Called me for what? Some lady wants you on the telephone. I had to get dressed to come get you. He never got phone calls. Leslie had called him exactly once, and Brenda had gone into such a song and dance with her about just getting a call. Getting a call from his sweetheart that Leslie had decided it was simpler to come to the house and get him when she wanted to talk. Sounds kind of like Miss E-D-M-U-N-D-S. It was Miss E-D-M-U-N-D-S, Jess. Her voice flowed through the receiver. Miserable weather, isn't it? Yes, ma'am. He was scared to say more for fear she hear the shake. I was thinking of driving down to Washington. Maybe go to the Smithsonian or the National Gallery. How would you like to keep me company? He broke out in a cold sweat. Jess, he licked his lips and shoved his hair off his face. You still there, Jess? Yes, ma'am. He tried to get a deep breath so he could keep talking. Would you like to go with me, Lord? Yes, ma'am. Do you need to get permission? She asked gently. Yes. Yes, ma'am. He had somehow managed to twist himself up in the phone cord. Yes, ma'am. Just a minute. He untangled himself, put the phone down gently and tiptoed into his parents' room. His mother's back made a long hump under the cotton blanket. He shook her shoulder very gently. Mama, he was almost whispering. He wanted to ask her, without really waking her up. She was likely to say no if she woke up and thought about it. She jumped at the sound, but relaxed again. Not fully awake. Teacher wants me to go to Washington to the Smithsonian. Washington, the syllables were blurred. Yeah. Something for school. He stroked her upper arm. Be back before too late, okay? Don't worry, I done milking, She pulled the blanket to her ears and turned on her stomach. Just crept back to the phone. It's okay, Miss E-D-M-U-N-D-S. I can go. Great. I will pick you up in 20 minutes. Just tell me how to get to your house. As soon as he saw her cartoon and just whizzed out the kitchen door through the rain and met her halfway up the drive, his mother could find out the details from Maybelly. After he was safely up the road, he was glad Maybelly was absorbed in the TV. He didn't want her waking Mama up before he got away. He was scared to look back, even after he was in the car, and on the main road for fear he see his mother screaming after him. It didn't occur to him until the car was past Millsburg that he might have asked Miss EDMUNDS if Leslie could have come too. When he thought about it, he couldn't suppress a secret pleasure at being alone in the small cozy car with Miss EDMUNDS. She drove intently, both hands gripping the top of the wheel, peering forward. The wheels hummed, and the windshield wipers slickered a merry rhythm. The car was warm and filled with the smell of Miss EDMUNDS. Just sat with his hands clasped between his knees. The seatbelt tight across his chest. "Damn, Wayne," she said. "I was going stir crazy." "Yes, ma'am," he said happily. "You too, huh?" She gave him a quick smile. He felt dizzy from the closeliness. He nodded. Have you ever been to the National Gallery? To the National Gallery? "No, madam." He had never even been to Washington before. But he hoped she wouldn't ask him that. She smiled at him again. "Is this your first trip to an art gallery?" "To an art gallery, yes, ma'am. Great," she said. "My life has been worthwhile after all." He didn't understand her, but he didn't care. He knew she was happy to be with him, and that was enough to know. Even in the rain, he could make out the landmarks, looking surprisingly. The way the books had pictured them, the Lee Mansion high on the hill, the bridge, and twice around the circle, so he could get a good look at Abraham Lincoln, looking out across the city, the White House, and the monument, and at the other end of the Capitol. Leslie had seen all these places a million times. She had even gone to school with the girl whose father was a congressman. He thought he might tell Miss EDMUNDS later that Leslie was a personal friend of a real congressman. Miss EDMUNDS had always liked Lisa. Entering the gallery was like stepping inside the pine grove. The used vaulted marble, the cool splash of the fountain, and the green growing all around. Two little children had pulled away from their mothers and were running about screaming to each other. It was It was all Jess could do not to grab them and tell them how to behave and tell them how to behave in so obviously a scarce place. And then the pictures, room after room, floor after floor. He was drunk with color and form and new genius. And with the voice and perfume of Miss Edie Mundias always beside him, she would bend her head down close to his face to give some explanation or ask him a question, her black hair falling across her shoulders. Men would stare at her instead of the pictures and just felt they must be jealous of him for being with her. They ate a late lunch in the cafeteria. When she mentioned lunch, he realized with horror that he would need money, and he didn't know how to tell her that he hadn't brought any, didn't have any to bring for that matter. But before he had time to figure anything out, she said, "Now, I am not going to have any argument about his pain. I'm a liberated woman, just errands. When I invite a man out, I pay. He tried to think of some way to protest without ending up with the bill, but couldn't, and found himself getting a $3 meal, which was far more than he had meant to have her spend on him tomorrow. He would check out with Lisa how we should have handled things. After lunch, they trotted through the drizzle to the Smithsonian to see the dinosaurs and the Indians. There they came upon a display case holding a miniature scene of Indians disguised in buffalo skin, scaring a herd of buffalo into stampeding over a cliff to the death with more Indians waiting below to butcher and skin them. It was a three-dimensional nightmare version of some of his own drawings. He felt a frightening sense of a kinship with it. "Fascinating, isn't it, Miss Edie Mundias?" said her hair brushing his cheek as she leaned over to look at it. He touched his cheek. "Yes, ma'am." To himself, he said, I don't think I like it. But he could hardly pull himself away. When they came out of the building, it was into brilliant spring sunshine. Just blinked his eyes against the glare and the glisten. Wow, Miss Edie Mundias said, "A miracle. Behold the sun." I was beginning to think she had gone into a cave and vowed never to return, like the Japanese myth. He felt good again all the way home in the sunshine. Miss Edie Mundias told funny stories about going to college 1 year in Japan, where all the boys had been shorter than she, and she hadn't known how to use the toilets. He relaxed. He had so much to tell Lisa and ask her. It didn't matter how angry his mother was. She'd get over it, and it was worth it. This was one perfect day of his life. of his life was worth anything, he had to pay. One dip in the road before the old Perkins place, he said, just let me out at the road, Miss Edmunds. Don't try to turn in. You might get stuck in the mud. Okay, Jess, he said. She pulled over at his road. Thank you for a beautiful day. The western sun danced on the windshield, dazzling his eyes. He turned and looked Miss Edmunds full in the face. No, ma'am. His voice sounded squeaky and strange. He cleared his throat. No, but damn, thank you. Well, he hated to leave without being able to really thank her, But the words were not coming for him now. Later, of course, they would, when he was lying in bed or sitting in the castle. Well, he opened the door and got out. See you next Friday. She nodded, smiling. See you. He watched the car go out of sight and then turned and ran with all his might to the house. The joy jingling inside of him so hard that he wouldn't have been surprised if his feet had just taken off on the ground the way they sometimes did in dreams and floated him wide over the roof. He was all the way into the kitchen before he realized that something was wrong. His dad's pickup had been outside the door, but he hadn't taken it in until he came into the room and found them all sitting there, his parents and the little girls at the kitchen table, and E-L-L-I-E and Brenda on the couch, not eating. There was no food on the table, not watching TV. It wasn't even turned on. He stood unmoving for a second while they stared at him. Suddenly his mother let out a great shuddering sob. Oh my God, oh my God. She said it over and over. Her head down on her arms. His father moved to put his arm around her awkwardly, but he didn't take his eyes off Jess. I told ya, he just gone off somewhere, Maybelly said quietly and somberly, as though she had repeated it often, and no one had believed her. He squinted his eyes, as though trying to peel down a dark drain pipe. He didn't even know what question to ask them. What? He tried to begin. Brenda's pouting voice broke in. Your girlfriend's dead. And Mama thought you was dead too. That's the end. That's the end of chapter 10. Okay.
Sometimes it seems impossible, but your heart